Recorded Books presents Dead Men Don't Lie, an outlaw Torn Slater Western by Jackson Cain. Narrated by Chris Andrew Ciulla.
Pity poor Mexico. So far from God, so close to the United States. El Presidente Porfirio Diaz.
Prologue. A bullet always knows. High up in the San Carlos Mountains in southern Arizona, a woman with shoulder-length auburn hair sat cross-legged. She was studying the cliff face in front of her. Dressed in a blue close-fitting denim work shirt and Levi's, she sported an old, worn, light brown, scoop-brimmed work Stetson and hard-used riding boots, which were heeled with large steel rowels. She looked fit, and she was. Her long tresses, full mouth, flaring cheekbones, and expressive green eyes still drew stares, even from men a fraction of her 35 years. A pair of saddlebags were casually spread out on her lap. A black and white Appaloosa with a mottled rump was rain-standing beside her. The woman stared fixedly at the three circular points embedded in the cliff face. Each of them was approximately 2 inches in diameter. Two on top, one below, each approximately 18 inches from the other. Pale as old ivory, these discs were considered by her godmother and legendary Apache war shaman, Lozen, to be sacred. The woman needed something sacred at this moment. True, she and her husband, Frank, owned the largest ranch in the entire Arizona territory, as well as several extremely profitable silver mines, but now, it seemed, her wealth no longer mattered. For the past 20 years, the woman's life had gone from marvelous to monstrous. Her two headstrong children, 19-year-old Richard and 18-year-old Rachel, were continually running off on adventures. Their hair-raising exploits had always frightened the woman out of her wits. Richard's rock climbing, high diving, and heavyweight boxing drove Catherine to distraction, and she was convinced that Rachel's obsession with breaking wild Mustangs would be the death of her only daughter. But now the two had topped themselves. They had set out on another adventure in the dead of night, without warning, leaving only a letter of goodbye. In it, they explained that they were hopping a freight train down to Mexico. Traveling in peon garb, they intended to explore Sonora and Sinaloa, two of Mexico's most lawless states. Sinaloa was especially frightening. Brutally tyrannical, its titular head was a dimwit named Eduardo. His shockingly psychopathic stepmother, known throughout Mexico as La Senorita, really ran it, and she had brought back the torture chambers of the Spanish Inquisition and the sacrificial pyramids of the Aztecs, on one of whose summits her faux Aztec priests cut the hearts out of anyone who crossed her. In short, her political systems, which Porfirio Diaz privately and wholeheartedly supported, were derived from the worst excesses of the Spanish Inquisition and the Aztec Empire. Since the Senorita was also Diaz's most generous personal benefactor and political contributor, her power throughout Mexico was surpassed only by that of El Presidente Diaz. For the past decade, she and Mexico's vicious dictator, the same Porfirio Diaz, had embarked on a path of conquest and had subjugated almost everything and everyone in Mexico. Only the state of Sonora had fought them off and remained free. But Sinaloa and Chihuahua, under Diaz and the Senorita, had allied themselves against Sonora, and that state's days seemed to be numbered. The Senorita let everyone know that after Sonora, she also planned to come north and reclaim the Arizona territory for herself and Diaz. The Senorita had spouted that theory one too many times, and Catherine's children decided it was time to stop speculating on Sinaloa and its empire from hell and find out what was really going on. In the letter, they had characterized their expedition as a reconnaissance mission and fact-finding operation. They quoted Sun Tzu's dictum, "Know thy enemy." They believed they would return with indispensable intelligence, which will determine the survival or the extinction of El Rancho del Cielo. As Frank had once observed, the two young people suffered the curse of Odysseus' incurable curiosity, which will lead only to cyclopes, sirens, Ciulla, Charybdis, and witches who turn people into swine, Catherine had added. Then why are they doing it? Frank had asked. They like living close to the bone, on the razor's edge, on the hair trigger's trembling touch. In other words, they're like their mother was when she was their age, Frank had answered. Catherine had been abducted by the Apache as a child, and Frank believed the experience had left her with a wild, rebellious streak, and there was some truth to his theory. But contrary to much rumor and false report, Catherine was not made of stone and was not impervious to fear or anxiety. And now Catherine was facing something more unbearable. Frank had always been a dynamo of indefatigable energy. Not only was he the foremost surgeon in the entire American Southwest, and not only was he running that region's most modern, scientifically advanced surgical hospital, he was also indispensable in running and expanding the ranch and their mines. Now, however, he was constantly in bed and devastatingly exhausted. Even worse, over the last several months, he'd begun experiencing intestinal pain. Then came the diagnosis, terminal abdominal cancer. And her children were down in Mexico, incommunicado. Catherine secretly feared that all she and Frank could do was hope that their children were safe and wait the disease out. Until finally, Frank's suffering came to its inevitable end. Catherine, however, was not good at waiting things out, which was why she'd come up to the San Carlos Mountains to meet with her lifelong friend and mentor, Spirit Owl. Seated earlier that morning in his heat lodge, a brush wiki-up filled with aromatic smoke and scorchingly hot steam, Spirit Owl had spoken to her of her children.
Everyone is an individual with a different destiny. You have to learn to leave people alone. Frank, as well as your children. You have to learn to let them choose and follow their destinies. You have to stop manipulating everyone.
If I had adopted that attitude 20 years ago, there would be no Rancho del Cielo. It has survived and thrived precisely because I have, when necessary, told people what to do, even when they resisted. It's survived because I have run it with an iron hand.
But you run the lives of those you love with that same iron hand, even when they need kindness and understanding.
I can't help interfering in their lives if they are hurting themselves and those around them. Non-interference in such situations isn't love.
You came to me because you're depressed. That's because, in truth, you don't do good deeds for their own sake. You do good works because you live to control people. Now you feel that control slipping through your fingers. Frank is ill. Your children are in Mexico. You can't manipulate them, and you mourn the loss of your power.
Richard and Rachel went down to Mexico and into the heart of hell. You're saying I shouldn't have tried to stop them? I should have let them go. Let them get tortured and killed?
Did it ever occur to you that they did the right thing?
The rancho knows nothing about Sinaloa.
It was time you learned what you're up against.
But our spies are my children.
Oh, I get it. It's okay to send someone else's children down there, but not your own.
Catherine buried her face in her hands. Spirit Owl, I'm losing my grip.
You mean you're losing your control?
Catherine raised her head and stared at the owl angrily. Richard and Rachel kept their trip a secret from me. Had I known, you bet I would have controlled them. I would have locked them up and tied them down till the insanity passed.
That's because you're a miserable person, Catherine. And you aren't happy unless you're making those around you miserable. Grow up and learn to stop meddling.
His advice depressed her even more. She'd brought her Colt 44 Army-issue pistol, ostensibly to fight off pumas, javelinas, and diamondbacks. But, as of late, she had increasingly considered another use for it. A little voice said inside her head,
"I'm sorry, Frank. Richard, Rachel, Owl. I just can't take it anymore."
She put the pistol to her temple, and after a moment of silence, pulled the trigger. Suddenly, she saw Spirit Owl in a vision. She said to him,
"Am I dead?"
"No," the owl said, "just in Arizona."
"I'm supposed to be dead."
"You're supposed to stop feeling sorry for yourself."
"I don't care. Everyone else gives up," Catherine said. "Why shouldn't I?"
"You have to care," Spirit Owl said. "You have work to do. Anyway, it's not your time."
"How do you know?"
"Because I'm the owl."
The vision faded, and she heard the hammer dry snap on a dead round.
Click!
The owl was right. The bullet told her. And a bullet always knows. Part 1.
"How about un abrazo? All you gringos like the abrazo. Major Mateo Cardoso."
Chapter 1. Rachel Ryan stood at the Hermosillo Cantina Bar, staring into her glass of tequila. Glancing around the crowded taberna, she absently noted the 24 tables with their quartets of straight-backed chairs. Coal oil lamps were bracketed against the walls, and 20 or so hung randomly from the ceiling. In a corner, a mariachi band played all the great plaintive Mexican songs, "Corrido, Dormir Contigo, Te Desean, La Incondicional, Mi Terco Corazón, El Son de la Negra, Algo Tienes, La Cárcel de Cananea, Tu Amor, Vive el Verano, La Paloma," as well as hers and Richard's personal favorite, "La Golondrina." The band included a trumpet, an accordion, a violin, a high-pitched, round-backed vihuela guitar, and its big, bulky bass counterpart, a guitarrón. The cantina featured a large dance floor. Since Sonora's main fort was nearby, half the clientele were soldiers in gray uniforms. A dozen or more cavalry officers had on brown, roweled riding boots, which clinked on the wood floor when they walked. The other half of the clientele were civilians. White cotton shirts and faded Levi's were popular among the civilian men, white cotton dresses among the women. Since La Paloma was an upscale cantina, even the putas sported white cotton dresses. Fluent in Spanish, Rachel and her brother Richard both understood the song lyrics around them. After 3 months in this country, she was even dreaming in Spanish. Rachel listened to La Golondrina, absently taking in the song's words.
¿A dónde irá, veloz y fatigada la golondrina? Que de aquí se va por si en el viento se hallará, extraviada buscando abrigo y no lo encontrará.
Ever the clown, Richard mockingly warbled the English translation,
"Where can it go, rushed and fatigued, the swallow, passing by, tossed by the wind, looking so lost with nowhere to hide?"
"Sort of summarizes our whole trip, doesn't it?" Rachel said. Richard let out a long sigh.
"Are you questioning the wisdom of our venture?"
"Maybe."
"Don't let Mom hear you say that," Richard said. "She'll never let us live it down. Sneaking off like we did in the dead of night, then coming back broke, our tails between our legs, admitting we screwed up."
I'm starting to wonder why we came here at all, Rachel said. We wanted to know if Sinaloa was as bad as we'd heard, and if it posed a threat to El Rancho, which it does. I wanted to hook you up with our Lady Dolorosa, Rachel said. Now it was her turn to mock. Yeah, right. Pimp me out. Maybe I could earn us train fare back. From what I hear, her lovers do not find her generous, Rachel said. She's built an Aztec pyramid behind her main hacienda. She's installed Aztec priests and brought back their rituals. Her priests even conduct human sacrifices atop those temples. That's where she sends the lovers who disappoint her, Rachel said. After her Grand Inquisitor finishes with them in his torture chambers, Richard said. That's when her Aztec priests take over, Rachel said. After flaying them whole, they cut out their hearts atop those pyramids, then bleed their remains out into troughs, like stuck pigs. That's only because they failed to satisfy her in bed, Richard said, thumping his chest, which in my case could never happen. You're different, virgin boy, Rachel said, taunting him with her favorite nickname for him, and the one he hated the most. My strength is as the strength of 10, because my heart is pure. What's that from? Rachel asked. Tennyson, Richard said. Idylls of the King, but don't bother reading it. You wouldn't get it. Why? It's literature. Rachel gave her brother a condescending frown. 6 rurales in gray silver-trimmed uniforms and dark brown riding boots, heeled with razor-sharp buzzsaw rowels, bellied up to the bar on their right. They had 44 Colt revolvers on their hips and bandoliers crisscrossing their chests. They all wore broad-brimmed sombreros with triple-creased steeple crowns, which matched their uniforms. The tallest of the 6 pounded on the bar with his palm. Elena, the woman who owned the cantina and served the drinks, didn't take anything off anybody, and she glared at him. An attractive widow. Her hair was as black as a crow's wing, and her tight-fitting red cotton dress showed her figure off to her considerable advantage. She was a successful, good-looking businesswoman. Men vied for her attention and tried hard to stay on her good side. Mateo, she warned the officer, keep it up, and Antonio will break a shotgun butt on your thick skull. Major Mateo Cardoso grinned widely. Under his black, downward-sweeping horseshoe mustache, his white, even teeth shone brilliantly. Mateo and Elena were both playing a favorite game. 1,000 pardons, senorita, Mateo implored, and a compliment on your belleza. Also a bottle of tequila for my men and myself, por favor. I can see you hombres have already had a bottle somewhere else. 2 bottles, Mateo said. You have to make 5 a.m. roll call, not me. She gave him a bottle and 6 glasses. He gave her the money. Who knows, senorita? Corporal Rinaldi said. He pulled himself up to his full 5 feet 6 inches of height, his forehead furrowed, but his dark eyes glittering. Tomorrow we may not even be in the army. That is a fact, Mateo concurred. What's wrong? Elena asked, polishing a glass.
We have to figure out those goddamn howitzer trajectories.
Sergeant Enrique,
the big bearded guy, muttered under his breath. And until we do, those damn guns won't hit shit. General Ortega is madder than hell at me, Mateo admitted.
Diaz and the Senorita are planning another attack. And if we can't get our artillery up and running, we're screwed.
We're all screwed, Elena said softly, nodding. Rachel gave Richard a quick, hard look. I'm going to the excusada, she said. Then let's slope on out of here. I've had it with Mexico Lindo. This whole trip was a boss. As much as I hate to admit it, Mom was right. We'll figure out how to find our way back to Arizona tomorrow. Richard nodded his agreement,
Verdad. Mateo was still complaining about his cannons.
That's because those cannons are old Napoleons, and no one has fired them in a decade. The generals can't expect us to learn this shit overnight. We don't even know how to aim the damn guns.
I don't even know how much powder to use,
Rinaldi said.
Or how to make the right kind of Idepuda powder, Mateo said.
We're using the same mix of sulfur, charcoal, and saltpeter that we used to load rifles,
Enrique said.
Except those howitzers aren't saddle rifles, Mateo said.
They aren't handguns either,
Enrique said.
Why did General give us the job anyway?
Enrique asked.
We're cavalry. We ain't no artillery.
Someone has it in for us,
Rinaldi said.
He gave the job to me, Mateo said. Not to you, hombres. You won't get blamed. I will. And Ortega will be right. I was supposed to figure out how to make those guns work. I let him down.
It's not our fault that Sonora doesn't have real artillery officers,
Rinaldi said. Richard had just graduated at the top of his class from West Point as an artillery officer. He was so young, though, only 19, that they asked him to take a year off before the army gave him a field commission. Emboldened by 3 shots of tequila, Richard tore a sheet of writing paper from his knapsack pad and began filling it with ballistics equations. He then tapped Mateo on the shoulder.
You have 3 basic problems, Richard said. You need someone from your university who knows integral calculus to compute your trajectories. He'll understand these equations here.
Richard wrote out a glossary, defining the symbols.
He then has to find a good book on the chemistry of explosives. He will then be able to tell you how to mix the cordite you need to power your shells.
Cordite?
Mateo asked.
None of the European great powers are using black powder for their artillery and their other high-powered weapons,
Richard said. Not anymore. America is phasing it out, too.
You'll need nitroglycerin if you want to manufacture nitrocellulose and nitroguanidine, both of which you really need if you want to produce the cordite necessary for really high-quality howitzer powder. It's not easy to make, though.
I can't even make a shell go 100 yards, Mateo grunted, eyes downcast.
Aim the guns at a 45-degree angle for maximum range, Richard said, and then...
Stopping in mid-sentence, he looked up from his paper full of equations and saw the troopers were all circling around him, staring at him, fixedly, fascinated. A little too fascinated. Mateo was suddenly putting his arm around his shoulders.
You had to show off, didn't you? Richard cursed silently. How in living hell do you get out of this one?
Rachel came back. Hearing Richard's last remarks and seeing the paper full of equations, she instantly realized how badly Richard had screwed up. She removed Mateo's arm from Richard's shoulders.
Richard, we are out of here.
Chapter 2. A woman in a black robe stood with the youthful captain of the guard on the 3rd step of the Great Pyramid of Quetzalcoatl. The widowed stepmother to the governor of Sinaloa. She was that state's true ruler, and now ran Chihuahua as well. She was also the wealthiest woman in all of Central America. She had made countless enemies over the years, and if she truly wanted to go out in public, she was wise to do it incognito. The black robe effectively disguised her appearance. With the hood up, most people mistook her for a priest. She wanted to stand next to the young capitan during the next few minutes and watch his reaction when the enormity of his fate finally and irrevocably sank in. She had commissioned this particular pyramid almost 15 years before. She had overseen its construction and had visited it countless times. Still, it never failed to impress her. Close up, it was so vast that no one could fathom its dimensions. It was as if it encompassed the entire universe.
Its square base was 300 yards along the edges. Its sloping sides were lined with hundreds of steps, so numerous they seemed to reach the sun. At its top, off to one side, was the sanctuary of Quetzalcoatl, the god king. Many Mexicanos viewed him as the Aztec Jesus Christ. Quetzalcoatl was the only god in their firmament who had once lived and walked among them, and who actually liked the Mexicano people. Hanging on the sanctuary wall atop the temple was a stunning representation of Quetzalcoatl, an immense mosaic rendered in gold, silver, and turquoise. But on the flat summit also stood several gesticulating priests, brandishing machetes and obsidian carving knives. Before them was a limestone altar, 4 feet high and 6 feet long, the infamous stone on which countless victims had been, as the Lady Dolorosa liked to mockingly put it with a sly sneer curling her upper lip, heartlessly sacrificed. Shrouded in human skins, crowned with gleaming headdresses of elaborately woven eagle plumes, gemstones, and glittering strands of finely spun silver and gold, the blood-stained holy men harangued the roaring throng, shaking their big, gore-dripping obsidian knives at the howling masses below. The pyramid was cordoned off, and federales kept the surrounding mob approximately 100 feet from the temple's base. The Senorita needed federales to control them. The crowd numbered in the thousands, and they howled continually, "Blood for Quetzalcoatl!" She still could not believe how popular her human sacrifices were with Sinaloa's populace. 4 hulking novitiates appeared at the pyramid's base with the terrified wretch in hand. Partially flayed by the Grand Inquisitor, he was almost too weakened to resist. But one glimpse of the priests, their knives, the stone, and he was a raving madman with the strength of the demented. The Senorita had chosen her spot on the pyramid well. Her ex-lover was about to be dragged, kicking and screaming, past her on his way up the terraced steps to the sacrificial stone. In fact, he was so close, she could discern his whip welts, burns, knife slashes, his missing teeth and fingernails, to say nothing of large swaths of stripped-away skin. From the way his right arm was bent and pressed against his chest, she inferred that her inquisitor had dislocated that shoulder, probably on the strapado or the rack. There. They were dragging him up the first step, less than 10 feet from her. "Hey, hombre," she yelled at him. Recognizing her voice, he abruptly turned his head and stared straight into her eyes. The shock of recognition shook him to his core.
"Why are you doing this to me?" he shouted at her. "What did I do to you?"
She quickly crossed the short distance between them. The priests, sensing who she was, quickly stopped on the fourth step. Mounting that step, she leaned toward the captain, her mouth and eyes bursting into a blazing sunburst of a smile. When the two of them were nose to nose, eyes locked, she said,
"You were a truly terrible fuck."
The Lady Dolorosa spoke softly, her smile still grand and glorious. Looking back at her new major, a man whose name she also could not, did not remember, and would never remember, and staring him straight in the eye, she grinned condescendingly and said,
"Got the picture, puto? You comprende? That's what happens to hombres who can't cut it between the sheets."
Chapter 3. The big man in the black plainsman hat with the flat crown and broad, uncreased brim stared into the campfire. Dropping to one knee, he fed several dried-out cottonwood branches into the blaze, warmed his hands, and then drank some more mezcal out of the neck of the bottle.
"We gonna take that bank, Torn?"
the man on his right said. Slater passed the bottle to his friend and nodded slowly. He'd done time with Moreno in the Sonoran pit, arguably the worst of Mexico's many despicable slave labor prison mines, for 3 long years. And he trusted him. They'd been through hell together, and Luis did every minute of it standing straight up. If he couldn't rely on the man here on the outside, he couldn't rely on anyone, and Slater couldn't take down major banks and payroll trains all by himself. Even worse, since Slater was wanted in 13 states and territories, as well as the states of Sonora, Sinaloa, and Chihuahua, and had the same $20,000 price on his head in both the U.S. and Mexico, trust was a luxury he couldn't usually afford. But for 3 years, he and Moreno had survived that prison hellhole together, and afterward, they'd robbed banks and trains together. Yes, Moreno was a man you could ride the river with. Their third man, Alberto Segundo, sitting on his saddle blanket by the staked-out horses and finishing his dinner, was another story. His older brother, Roberto, had been Moreno's oldest friend, and that man had proven himself in the Sonoran pit as well. He'd finally died there, trapped in a cave-in. Before he'd died, however, he'd convinced Moreno to take his little brother on a job, if they ever got out. And it turned out they needed Alberto. They were short a man. Time was running out. The payroll was about to arrive at the bank, and so they'd taken him on. None of which meant they could rely on him. His appearance alone reeked of lifelong failure and bad mistakes. He was missing half his teeth and one eye. There was nothing anyone could do about that, but he was also a drunk, and he stank. They had to force him to wash himself, his clothes, and his long, straggly, stinking hair in the occasional stream. He couldn't stop his almost insane boasting about how tough he was, how many federales he'd killed, how many banks he'd knocked over, and how many trains he'd robbed. Any man who bragged about such stuff to outlaw Torn Slater was clearly muy ignorante y muy maniaco. But they didn't have time to find anyone else. Think Alberto will hold up his end? Slater asked. All he has to do is guard those remounts for us up the trail. I wouldn't trust him to carry a dozen tamales across a street. He'll do it, Luis said. He'll be there. If he isn't there, he won't get his end. Slater stared at him, silent. If he's not there, Torn, we'll hunt him down and kill him. Torn Slater was still silent. You want me to kill him, amigo? Now? Just say the word. Not yet. Maybe he'll do his job. Stranger things have happened, Moreno said, nodding his head. Slater looked away. Hey, compadre, Moreno said, smiling, hoping to lighten Slater's mood. What you want to do at your end? Slater shrugged. Same as always. What's that? Moreno said, genuinely curious. Hard liquor, fast women, slow horses. And waste the rest? Moreno said, finishing the rest. Verdad. Then what? Rob every bank, fuck every woman, and kill every swinging dick lawn son of a bitch that gets in my way. You left out trains, Moreno said. We blow them también. Trains, too, Slater said. Moreno shook his head sadly. What's wrong? Slater asked. Is that all you think about? Pesos, gatito, y muerta? What else is there? Slater said. We rob banks and trains for a living. We don't live lives of fine distinction. But blood and putas, pesos and death, that ain't no life for us. Not siempre. Slater allowed him a not unfriendly smile. We got tequila, too. Now Moreno looked away, shaking his head, unamused. So what you want to do with all this money? Slater asked. Invest it with El Presidente Porfirio or J. Pierpont Morgan, the Senorita? Try that and she'll put us in one of her prison mines. I got nothing against mines.
I got a mine up in the Sierra Madres. Very remote. We take that bank money and head on up there. We pick up provisions along the way, and when we get there, we bury the money nearby. We work the mine, sluice the streams, and when we get bored, we hunt game and we fish. They got deer, antelope, trout, and bass like you ain't never seen in your life. In the nearby Indios villages, they got muchas buenas Indias puras if we want chiquitas. And who knows? Maybe we also take a fortune in oro puro out of that mine. Main thing is, we don't come down off that mountain till the federales forget who we are, forget what we did, and forget we'd ever been. Then we get ourselves a real life, with no more banks to hit, no more trains to rob, and no more lawmen dogging our trail.
Slater stared at his amigo, silent.
Verdad?
Moreno finally asked.
Verdad, but amigo, we got one more bank to rob tomorrow morning.
But still, think about that mine, amigo. The hunting and fishing. The chiquitas. How long has it been since you relaxed? You interested?
I'm interested in that next bank, Slater said.
I know, amigo. We got one more bank to rob. Always one more bank and train to rob. But after that, we back off for a while, no? Promise me you'll think about it.
Slater slapped his friend on the shoulder.
See me, amigo. I'll think about it.
Why not?
Why the hell not?
Chapter 4. In the cantina, Rachel politely removed the major's arm from her brother's shoulder.
He's not coming with you, she said to Mateo.
Major Mateo Cardoso did not seem upset. Treating her to an affectionate grin, he said,
Si, I understand completely.
Mateo picked his military hat up from the bar and placed it over his heart.
But on the other hand, there are some hombres muy malos y muy duros in this benighted land, and when two gringos, such as yourselves, come here so far from home, they have need of amigos such as us, no?
We have muchos buenos amigos here already, Rachel said. We aren't alone.
She and Richard both hesitated to say who their parents were. Their ransom would be worth a fortune.
I am sure you are not, guapa, Mateo said.
And you aren't taking him with you, Rachel said, standing her ground and holding Richard's arm.
I really don't know much about artillery anyway, Richard said, still trying to backpedal. I was only spouting off.
Richard, Rachel said, shut up.
Mateo gave them both another captivating smile.
What can I do to prove I love you? That I am a man of trust? How about un abrazo? All you gringos like the abrazo.
Mateo was a big man, at least 6'2", with broad shoulders, and under his tan army shirt, his biceps bulged. Richard, however, was a good 6'4", and had the muscles of a seasoned rock climber, which was what he was. He'd also boxed, wrestled, and done high-platform diving at West Point. Still, when Mateo wrapped Richard in his big, burly arms, Richard felt as if he'd been embraced by a grizzly bear.
Si, Mateo said. I give your brother the abrazo. We are amigos. Now, siempre. I will never go back on that.
A crowd was gathering around them now, which not only made Rachel even more nervous, it seemed to bother Mateo.
Tell you what, he said to Rachel. Let's you and me go outside and discuss these. Too many ears in here. We'll work something out. We won't shanghai anybody. We're soldados, not hombres malos.
Apprehensive, but still wanting to hear what he said, Rachel followed Mateo out the side door and into the alley.
Those hombres back there, they aren't as simpatico as me, Mateo said. They get the whole of you? They'll drag you into this alley and rape you so malo duro, you'll never fuck again.
Not me.
I'm uno mucho bueno hombre.
And I'm una mucha buena mujer. But you take my brother, and I won't stop till I kill you. You die, and I'll carve my name on your tombstone. I'll harrow hell for your excremento stinking soul. Suddenly, Rachel saw a blur, and Mateo's big right hand slapped her temple hard enough to ring temple bells and hang stars. Slamming her head against the adobe wall behind her, Mateo grabbed her throat and whispered,
"You wash your mouth, puta. I'll drag you out of here in shackles and leg irons. I'll sell your gringa ass into a casa de puta dura bruta. You'll die there turning muchos tortuosos tricks."
But Rachel wouldn't back down. Shaking loose from Mateo's grip, she began beating on his chest with her fists, ripping his cheeks with her fingernails, kicking his shins with her heavy boots. She was about to shout her mother's name. She was so angry she didn't care what happened.
"We have connections," she shouted. "We're not nobodies. Our mother is one of the most powerful people in North America. We'll come after you with police, politicians, whatever it takes. Our mother will..."
But she never got it out. In a blind, red-eyed rage, Mateo thundered,
"Puta!"
Then he hit her in the left temple, not with his fist, but with the shot-loaded, whip-spring buttstock of his wrist's quirt, a makeshift blackjack. She didn't pass out immediately. She stared at him in what seemed to be wide-eyed wonder.
"What the fuck?"
was all she said. Then her eyes slowly closed. Passing out, she slid down the cantina wall. Rubbing his torn cheek, Mateo stared in shock at her, at what he'd done.
"Lo siento, chiquita," he said to her sadly. "I think I maybe killed you, but you caught me muy loco."
He studied her for one more long, hard moment.
"Oh, fuck it," he finally said with a head-shaking shrug.
"Así es como sucede a veces."
"That's the way it happens sometimes."
Heading back into the cantina, he grabbed Richard and dragged him out to their mounts, which were tied to the cantina's hitch rack. When his men came out with his hat and jacket, he commandeered one of the cantina patrons' horses and told Richard to mount up. Instead, Richard started to turn around and look for his sister. But before Richard could go into the alley and find her, Mateo laid the quartz leaded stock over the top of his head. Catching Richard on the way down, Mateo hoisted him up face first and belly down across the saddle of the confiscated bay. Using a coiled saddle rope to secure Richard, Mateo grabbed the horse's mecate and swung onto his big horse. Dallying the mecate around his pommel, he led his men and Richard, trussed up, unconscious, and belly down over the mount, toward the army fort.
"Amigo," Mateo said to the unconscious Richard, "welcome to the Sonora Rurales."
Part 2.
What's more important, pesos in your saddlebags or notches on your pistola? Luis Moreno, Outlaw.
Chapter 5.
Lady Dolorosa and her new capitan watched the four novitiates drag the lady's ex-lover up the temple's stepped slope. She was giving him a shy, demure wave.
"Yes, I shall almost miss you, whatever your name was. We did have some fine times."
"We must have. I kept you around for over a month."
She looked at her new prospect.
"To tell you the truth, I don't remember much about any of my lovers. When I try to recall their faces and features, it's as if their memories seem to vanish without a trace. In my head, they all blur into a single, generic, composite male."
She turned to her prospect.
"But every day is a new beginning, and now I have you.
Any questions?"
she asked, giving him her most endearing smile.
"I was curious why we're here," he said nervously.
"Think of this as motivation.
That's what I try to instill in all my eager young boys, the passion to serve and excel.
To serve and excel in the service of Madre Mexico? He asked, confused.
Lady Dolorosa broke into a series of mocking, mean-spirited giggles.
No, silly. I'm talking about fealty to my bed and body, of course. I thought you knew. I can't sleep nights, and one of the few things that distracts me in those dreadful nocturnal hours is really good
sex.
You able to excel in that department?
You better be. Of course, my lady. You're the most beautiful, irresistible woman I've ever seen, and you're my ruler.
Funny, that's just what who's it up there on the pyramid used to say. Flattering words, however, are no substitute for action and endurance. Stamina, that's what I require from my willing young men. Juggernaut stamina. I do hope you're up to the task, unlike what's-his-face.
An almost preternaturally shrill and piercing scream ripped through their conversation like a thunderbolt.
Ah, the pièce de résistance! Lady Dolorosa shouted to her new capitán above the crowd's ear-cracking cheers.
Her former lover, up on the altar, was still alive, and the señorita's head priest was covered with the man's gore as he stabbed and hacked his way into his chest cavity. Reaching deep into it, the priest slashed the aortas and yanked out his victim's still throbbing heart. After shoving it straight into the man's hysterically screaming face, he lifted it high overhead for the crazed congregation to see. He then tossed it into a huge ceramic crock filled with the hearts of those previously immolated. His assistants hung her ex-lover by the heels over a nearby edge, along which a gutter ran all the way down into a ground trough. As thoroughly as any slaughtered steer, the man was finally exsanguinated, his blood filling a huge ceramic crock below. When she looked back up at the summit, the head priest was hacking at the man's neck with a black, razor-sharp obsidian blade. When he cut through, the man's head slipped off the altar and hit the stone summit with a sickening crack. The priest picked up the head by the hair and flung it down the terraced slope. It hit every one of the hundreds upon hundreds of steps on the way down.
Goodbye, Pancho,
she muttered half aloud.
Or whatever the hell your name was. Do you wish to go anyplace else? The capitán said, looking a little queasy.
No, this has been amusement enough. I have to get back to the palace before my colossal joke of a stepson burns the place down. You can do whatever you have to do. My bodyguards here will take me back, but I must see you tonight at 10 p.m. sharp. Don't be late.
I'm looking forward to it.
That's what they all say.
Until then?
Until then, el dopo.
She pinched his cheek so long and hard that his squinting eyes teared, and the bruise quickly turned garishly, sickeningly livid. Studying her handiwork, she could not resist pinching it again, and again, and again. Turning abruptly, she headed toward her team of bodyguards, which had remained a discreet 20 or so feet behind them. When she reached them, she paused for just a second to look back at her new lover.
Just one more thing, Capitan.
Yes, my lady?
Do not ever disappoint me. I'm the last woman in the world you want to disappoint.
Chapter 6 Two hard-case strangers in black frock coats, matching broad-brimmed hats, and white shirts with black dangling bow ties, rode up Culiacan's main street. With two huge, bulging carpet bags strapped to each of their saddles, they easily passed for two ranchers arriving at the bank to make a deposit. Even the pack mule following them, laden with panniers, crossbucks, and more carpet bags, would not have raised suspicions.
El primer banco nacional y fiduciario de Sinaloa
was the biggest bank in the state, and Culiacan was that state's capital and its biggest city. The bank was used to large deposits and withdrawals. Dismounting, the men each gave their reins two quick turns around the bank's hitch rack, two turns guaranteed that the horse's bits would injure their mouths if they tried to bolt, but they weren't tied up tight enough to slow the men's escape. They entered the bank, Moreno first, then Slater. It had just opened, and behind the cashier's windows stood three men. They wore green forehead visors, white boiled shirts with black elbow garters, to prevent them from shoving money up their sleeves and into their shirts, and celluloid collars. As of yet, there were no customers. It was still too early. Moreno spoke to the security guard in a dark blue policeman's uniform, asking for the manager's office.
"To the left,"
the man said, studying the two strangers carefully. All the while, the guard, with studied nonchalance, rested his right hand on his holstered pistol.
"We're here to make un gran deposito, señor,"
Moreno said to the manager, entering his office and pointing toward their six valises and smiling.
Un muy magnifico deposito.
Entering the manager's office, Slater studied the bearded, dark-suited manager seated at his big dark wood desk. He immediately stood to greet them. Three dark wood armchairs faced his desk, and behind him a small couch was flush against the wall. A portrait of El Presidente Porfirio Diaz hung behind the man's desk. A placard on the desk read, "Manager, Juan Hidalgo." Rounding his desk, Hidalgo said, smiling, his hand out,
"What's this I hear about un deposito gran y magnifico?"
"Here, my friend, let me show you," Moreno said, putting his two valises on the couch behind him and shaking his hand. Placing his two valises on the floor, Slater quietly slipped out of the office. Reaching into the bag, Moreno pulled out a sawed-off 12-gauge greener and shoved it into the manager's crotch.
"I'm gonna blow your cojones to Kingdom Come if you don't open that safe and deposit all that gringo gold you got this morning in these satchels."
Catching the blur of motion, Moreno glanced sideways just in time to see Torn Slater whip a thin stiletto out of his sleeve and backhand the guard's throat hard enough to sever his trachea, his jugular, and carotid. Stepping to the right, Slater narrowly ducked a deluge of blood geysering out of the guard's throat. He then kicked the pistol, which the guard had just drawn, out of the man's fist. Picking it up, Slater shoved it in his belt.
"On the floor!"
Slater shouted, pulling his own pistols and pointing them at the three cashiers standing at their open windows. The three men dropped to the floor, face down and shaking, as if they'd been shot. There were still no customers.
"That money's not worth dying for," Moreno said to the manager, "which is what you'll all do if you don't open that safe ahora."
The scattergun was still crowding the manager's crotch, so for emphasis, Moreno eared the double hammers back to full cock.
"You don't want those pesos to cost you your cojones," Moreno added to the manager. "You and your family don't mean squat to Diaz. Start to doubt that will kill you, and take a look at that guard back there bleeding all over your floor. That's what happens if you try to stop us."
Head down, the manager nodded his acquiescence, pointing toward his right-hand desk drawer. He said,
"The key, señor, in there."
Moreno nodded.
"Get it, amigo, and then let's get them pesos."
Hidalgo removed the big brass key.
"It's down here,"
he said, pointing toward the heavy black wool rug covering his office floor.
"A floor safe?"
Moreno asked, surprised.
"Si, señor. Understando. You are stealing a personal loan from the United States government to El Presidente Porfirio Diaz. $150,000 in newly printed $100 bills. El Presidente will have to pay that loan back personally if Mexico is ever again to borrow money from foreign investors. Diaz will not rest until he hunts you down. He will move heaven and earth until he sees your souls in hell."
When Moreno looked into the open safe, he saw it was packed with countless stacks of banded, fresh-printed $100 bills.
"Y de puta," Moreno was finally able to mutter. "What the fuck have we got here?"
Chapter 7 Elena Vasquez sat on the edge of Rachel Ryan's bed. Emiliano Perez, the elderly, white-haired family doctor, sat across from Elena on the other edge of the bed. He wore wire-rimmed glasses and a pale gray suit with matching shirt, socks, and pants. Only his shoes were black. His eyes were warm but tired, and he was putting cold compresses on Rachel's hot, shattered temple very, very gently. Elena's close friend Antonio sat in the corner. His clothes were also white Mexicano garb, but he wore leather shoes, not rope sandals. He stood 6'3", and even under baggy clothes, his muscles seemed massive. His neck was as thick as a telegraph pole. He said nothing. Antonio seldom said anything, but it was common knowledge that he would follow Elena into the grave.
Elena, Dr. Perez said, the woman has suffered a fracture of the left temple, which happens to be very dangerous. It's one of the thinnest areas in the skull, and quite susceptible to shattering when struck with a blunt instrument. Additionally, it has an artery riding right under the area of the fracture and through the cerebrum. It's called the mid-cerebral artery. Indispensably vital to the cerebrum's blood flow, it has been severely compromised. The temple bones are fragmented and bleeding between the skull and the dura mater, which covers the brain, can result in a subdural hematoma. In other words, she has an extremely serious, extremely life-threatening concussion.
That de puta Mateo did that tour, Elena said.
And you feel compelled to help? Dr. Perez asked Elena.
Si.
She's not your responsibility, the doctor pointed out.
She entered my house, and mi casa es su casa. I was responsible. I am responsible.
You can't protect everyone, Dr. Perez said. But she's so young, has so much to live for, and they did this to her. And then they abducted her brother.
And mi casa!
I can do nothing, Elena.
You're a doctor, no? You can operate on her.
I would have to do a craniotomy, then assess both the condition of the brain and its dura, the protective tissue covering it. Afterward, I would have to remove the skull fragments and then reassemble them, putting a single piece of patchworked cranium back into place. There's no way I can do any of that. I don't have the skill, the equipment, or the trained personnel to assist me.
Dr. Perez rose, picked up his bag, and gave Elena a polite bow. She walked him out of the room, through the cantina, and to the door. After telling each other, buenas noches, he disappeared into the night, bag in hand. Elena returned to Rachel's room.
Antonio, Elena said, this woman and her brother came by themselves to our country unescorted, unprotected, trying, as she told me, to understand Madre Mexico, what I call this land of perdition.
Her brother was something special, Antonio agreed, nodding. He understood artillery, modern warfare. You saw how fast those diablos kidnapped him.
Inside her backpack, Elena said, she will have identification papers. Maybe we find out who her relatives are. Maybe we can notify them.
You better just hope she has money to pay you, Antonio said, for room and board.
It happened in mi casa. She owes us por nada.
Elena spat out the last two words angrily. Rachel's bag was on the floor near the foot of the bed. Going through it carefully, Elena found nothing.
Her papers must be in her clothes.
She had removed Rachel's clothes before putting her to bed. She'd worn a money belt under her pants. Going through it, Elena found an ID, stating that her name was Rachel Hendricks. She also had enough money to get her and her brother home. Still, it wasn't much to go on. Going through Rachel's pants, Elena found a second hidden pocket, directly behind the left rear button-down pocket, sewn into the back of the pants. The outside pocket contained the decoy wallet. The real ID was in the hidden pocket. She pulled out the real identification papers stared at it in blank astonishment, and read the ID aloud. Rachel Lydia Ryan. Brother, Richard Francis Ryan. Parents, Catherine Jane Paxton and Frank Herbert Ryan. Her mother is Catherine Ryan, Elena said, known down here as Gobernante del Mundo. She owns and runs El Rancho del Cielo in Arizona. She is the richest woman in the American Southwest. Rachel's father is also one of the most gifted surgeons in the Western Hemisphere, and a man who possesses the finest hospital and medical equipment in the Arizona Territory. I've read all about them. They're famous. Dr. Perez might not have the equipment to treat Rachel, but her father will, if we can get her there in time. Madre de Dios, Elena was sick of Mexico. Antonio, how would you like to take a long jornada by train?
To where?
El Rancho del Cielo, Rachel's parents' place.
Why not? Antonio said. They can't hurt us any worse than Diaz and the Senorita.
Chapter 8. When Richard came to, he was flat on his back on an iron cot in the Sonoran Rurales stockade. His head throbbed unbearably, and his pulse was hammering audibly in the high hundreds, as if someone were inside his skull, banging a gong or a bass drum. His cell was small, and the door was open. Security was obviously lax. Outside at a table, three bearded, uniformed guards sat smoking cigars, playing cards, and drinking what looked to be tequila. One of the card players made eye contact with Richard and shouted,
"Hey, Mateo! Sleeping Beauty just opened his eyes!"
Major Mateo Cardoso entered. He paused to take a swig from the neck of a mezcal bottle.
"Young Ricardo, you took some nap there. You must have been tired."
"How long was I out?"
Richard asked.
"A dozen hours."
"Feels like you ran my head through a hammer mill."
"My fault. I got to be more careful swinging with the cuarta's buttstock."
"Maybe it's just your nature to break skulls."
"Just so," Mateo roared with laughter.
"But here, I got something for your pain, something to put hair on your chest."
He handed Richard the mezcal bottle.
"Take a good swig. Muy bueno for the cojones to make you mucho hombre."
Richard needed something. He took a swig and almost spit it out. It burned both his throat and his stomach. Still, he kept it down. Within a few minutes, however, his head felt better.
"My young amigo," Major Mateo said, "we got off to a bad start, and I wanna make it up to you. You will see, I am not un hombre malo. I don't want you to spend your life in this brig, not even in the rurales. I just want you to join us for a little while. Eh, you can move into the officers' quarters. You teach me how to make gunpowder for his artillery. Then show me how to load, aim, and figure the trajectories of them puta guns. When we don't need you, you can leave and go back to Gringoland."
"You want help with your howitzers?"
"Those chingo tu madre howitzers."
"What makes them so important?"
"Sonora's the only state in Mexico left that can stand up to Sinaloa, to Diaz and the Senorita. They stomp all over everyone else."
"So those two are as bad as everyone says?"
"Those two are demonios del infierno. They torture and dismember people for laughs, and so far only we can stop them."
"It's not my fight."
"It's everybody's fight, mi amigo. If they get past us, your home, wherever that is, will be next."
Richard nodded, silently noting that he and his sister, wherever she was, were of the same opinion.
"And if you do help us," Mateo said, "you will be given mucho dinero. And even more important, you know what? Tequila y buenas mujeres?"
Richard asked with mocking derision.
and something much, much better. Libertad!
And if I say no? Matteo gave Ricardo his widest, most charming smile.
My young compadre, that is not a possibility you wish to contemplate. All our survivals are at stake. Yours too. If we do not make those guns work, we will all suffer the tortures of the damned and die a thousand times.
We will suffer a Sinaloan Inquisition?
I will, but not you. You, young muchacho, I will see you die a thousand times long before I do. I will see to it personally.
For once, Matteo wasn't smiling. Chapter 9. That night, Slater and Moreno rode into Alberto's camp behind the clump of boulders up in the Sierra Madre foothills. He was sitting in front of a blazing fire, drunk on tequila, shoving hot beans and tortillas into his mouth.
You got the pesos?
Alberto asked with an inebriated grin.
You got anything in your head except tamales y frijoles?
Moreno asked, swinging down from his horse. Alberto put down his beans. He stood and, lowering his hand onto his holstered pistol, he said,
You really wanna fuck with me?
Nobody wanna fuck anybody dumb as you, Slater said. Anyway, we got the pesetas. More than you can ever imagine.
Alberto still had his hand on his gun.
Hey, amigo,
Moreno said, slapping Alberto's back, giving him his widest, most ingratiating grin.
What's more important, huh? Pesos in your saddlebags or notches on your pistola? Come, bring the tequila. We got to celebrate. You are now a wealthy man.
Turning around toward his mount, Moreno unhooked a valise, opened it up, and tossed it at Alberto's feet. Bound up packs of $100 bills spilled out in front of the drunken man.
I knew you were simpatico,
Alberto said.
We will have mucho bueno times, you, Senor Slater, and me, no?
Hypnotized by the riches strewn in front of him, he knelt down and opened up money bag after money bag after money bag on the blanket in front of the fire.
It is mucho bueno, muy bueno,
the inebriated outlaw whispered. No, Slater said.
It's no good. No bueno.
The two bandits stared at Slater. Alberto was confused.
There's too much money in them bags, Moreno.
Didn't you hear the banker?
We didn't hit any federale payroll.
We intercepted a money shipment straight from the U.S. Treasury to El Presidente Diaz himself. We got us over 150,000 fresh minted Yankee $100 bills.
How many brand new hot off the printing presses $100 bills you ever seen in Mexico? Spend one of those? Take one into a bank, a hotel, take one any place, even into a dirt poor Chiapas cantina. And you'll have Diaz, his federales, his rurales, the U.S. Army, every bounty hunter south of the Rio climbing up our asses.
What do you suggest we do? Moreno asked.
I'm taking my share and going to ground. I'll stash it, live off the land till I can figure out how to spend it. It may take me years to dig it up.
You saying we got the fortune, but we can't spend it? Moreno asked.
Not one bill of it. It's so hot, it's smoking.
Es verdad, Moreno said softly, half to himself, finally understanding their problem.
You just ain't got the cojones to spend it, Alberto said, his hand once more hovering over his sidearm. I'm taking my share. Right back to my village. I left it like a thief in the night, but I'm coming back rich as Don Porfirio himself. I'm living like a grande from here on out, and any hombre says different, he's having it out with me.
Slater cross-drew a pistol out of his belt in a smooth single motion and shot the intoxicated man just above his right eye.
Had to be done, Moreno said, slowly nodding. He was a threat to both of us.
They paused only to eat the rest of the beans, washing them down with black coffee. Quickly, emptying the rest of the blackened pot onto the campfire, they kicked dirt over the rest. Unsaddling their horses, they walked to the remuda, threw the saddles onto their new mounts, and cinched them up. They threw a pad, crossbucks, and panniers onto a fresh mule. They then meticulously loaded the gear and money bags on it. They cut the exhausted stock loose.
We got fresh horses, a strong pack mule, mucho dinero, and a head start, Slater thought bleakly. That's all I ever asked for.
Chapter 10. Elena spread a thin gray mattress on the floor of the flatbed train car and covered it with a sheet, seating herself at the head of the mattress with her legs spread out and a dark pillow on her lap. Antonio gently placed Rachel on the mattress, easing her head onto Elena's pillow. Rachel's face was flushed with fever. Elena wiped her brow with a cool, wet washcloth.
You sure you want to ride on the flat car?
Antonio asked.
The air will be better here than in the boxcars,
Elena said.
If we catch a rainstorm or banditos attack, the boxcars will provide more protection.
Then we'll carry Rachel into a boxcar.
Elena looked down at Rachel and emitted a long, slow sigh. She was even more worried about the skull fracture than she had been back at the house. The fractured temple was depressed, which meant, according to Dr. Perez, that it was putting pressure on the brain. A surgeon, he had said, would need to do a craniotomy to inspect the condition of both the brain and the protective tissue enveloping it. The surgeon would then have to remove the skull segments, reassemble them, and put the jigsaw puzzle pieces of patchworked cranium back into place. Elena and Dr. Perez only knew of one doctor and one hospital within a radius of 1,000 miles that could conceivably perform the operation. Dr. Frank Ryan at El Hospital del Rancho, Rachel's father. No way it could be done in Mexico. Elena glanced at her pocket watch. She had inherited it from her grandfather. The brand B.W. Raymond, it was a big railroad watch with a white face and Roman numerals marking the minutes. She'd especially loved the anachronistic III, which represented the numeral 4. Since it was a railroad watch, it was the right timepiece for their trip. In fact, it was time for the train to pull out. As if on cue, the wood-fueled locomotive, which stood 4 cars ahead of them, screeched 3 long whistle bursts. Slowly, but with increasing frequency, its engine chugged, lurched, and strained, black smoke billowing out of the diamond-shaped stack. Gradually, the wheels rotated, and the cars jerked into motion. The train was thankfully taking off on time, something of a miracle in Mexico. Elena took that as a good omen. She needed the train to depart on time. The clock was running out on Elena and her patient. In 36 hours, the train would hopefully pull into a rail stop, which was a 1-hour wagon ride to the Ryan's Rancho. She would contact Catherine Ryan when she got there. She had been afraid to wire Catherine, telling her that she was bringing her daughter home, for fear that prospective kidnappers might intercept the message. Rachel would bring a queen's ransom down here. All Elena could hope was that she'd find a wagon and horses at the train station. Time was so precious. She'd sold her cantina in under 3 hours, in the same amount of time Antonio needed to book their train, then borrow a wagon and horses in which to drive them to the train station. She had packed hers and Antonio's rucksacks, 2 large canvas bags, and 3 2-gallon water bags. She did it as quickly as she could, since they were desperate to make the 2 p.m. train to the Arizona Territory. Her brother-in-law, Alfredo, had been trying to purchase her cantina for years, and now she'd sold it to him. He was stunned that she would pull up stakes, abandon virtually all of her possessions, and leave Sonora in such a hurry. She knew she was selling her establishment at fire sale prices, but she told Alfredo that she did not care. He was so insulting that it took every ounce of self-control to keep from shouting at him.
Chingo tu madre, puto! I'm going to Rancho del Cielo.
But she and Antonio could not tell their destination to anyone. Now her only fear was that they wouldn't get to the rancho in time to help Rachel. She wanted to scream at the fireman and engineer to throw more kindling into the firebox and get that damn train moving. Part 3. There was no law in Veracruz, no Sunday in Sinaloa, and no God south of Ciudad Juarez. Old Mexicano proverb. Chapter 11. After a breakfast of carne de cabra, frijoles, and tortillas, Mateo took Richard outside. The sun was at zenith and burned in the cloudless sky like a white-hot poker. The temperature was over 105 degrees, and the air was as dry as a cinder block. Before them lay the fort's huge square parade ground. 300 yards on edge, it teemed with companies of rurales, seemingly frenzied, but actually engaged in disciplined activity. Dozens of companies of soldiers, over 5,000 men in all, in sweat-stained gray uniforms and matching forage caps, practiced close-order drill. Under the stern, unblinking eye of obscenity-bellowing drill sergeants, they shouted out their sweltering cadences. Companies of recruits in sweat-soaked fatigues were performing interminable push-ups, jumping jacks, knee bends, sit-ups, and leg lifts, roaring out the numbers of their repetitions. Other companies practiced field stripping and reassembling their rifles. Whenever a company finished, the drill sergeant ordered them to take a half dozen laps around the field. Surrounding the parade ground were a score or more of huge, whitewashed, four-story adobe buildings. Half of them, Mateo told Richard, were barracks in whose bunk beds the base's soldiers slept each night.
Each of those barracks, Mateo said, holds hundreds of enlisted men. At night, we stack them like cordwood in triple bunk beds.
And you dragoon all of them into your army like you did me.
We practice universal conscription in Sonora. And yes, if they may resist, we enlist them by force.
I've died and gone to hell, Richard muttered.
No, we just walked past the guardhouse. That's hell.
Lovely, Richard said.
Off to the right are two mess halls. The men eat there three times a day.
Eat what?
The enlisted men leave on frijoles and tortillas. The latrines and showers are out back.
The enlisted men must need a lot of showers the way you work them, Richard said, glancing at the perspiring soldiers on the field.
Amigo, that is not possible. We suffer serious water shortages.
Beans and body stink, Richard said. Great.
We ride them hard and boot them up wet, Mateo said, a grin flickering under his black, downward-sweeping mustache.
Mateo pointed out offices, the dispensary, the officers' quarters.
What are those buildings like? Richard asked. The ones where you and the officers sleep.
Private rooms. All the showers you want.
The food?
Pollo, carne, and queso frijoles. Arroz, mangoes, café, cerveza, and tequila.
And women?
Muchas mujeres. You can even bring them into your rooms for the night.
And the enlisted barracks stink really bad?
The smell could drive a buzzard off a sheet wagon.
You suggesting I should enter officer candidate school?
He shrugged.
Meet a thought. But come, amigo, let us take a brief stroll.
Chapter 12. The Lady Dolorosa stared up at her bed's canopy. Its alabaster satin top and sides were fringed with matching lace. Reclining against a small mountain of fluffy white silk pillows, she casually surveyed her room. Everything was white, from the bedposts to the walls, from the thick rugs and carpets to her silk dressing gown. Once, when one of her court ladies asked her why she favored the color, she'd responded, "It's the color of virgins." Their laughter had been immense. Flinging her arms out, she emitted a huge, heartfelt sigh. After a night of desperate, almost demented debauchery, she felt sleepily, dreamily at peace. Still, all that exertion had given her a voracious appetite, and as soon as she had awakened, she'd shouted to no one in particular that she wanted her usual breakfast. Five of her ladies-in-waiting now entered, armed with breakfast trays. Chile rellenos, pollo con mole poblano, tortillas, sliced jalapenos, dishes of scorchingly hot salsa, all backed up by a large ice-filled pitcher of tequila, tomato juice, and Tabasco sauce, imported from the state of Tabasco, as well as six bottles of Pila Seca, a highly regarded Mexicano beer, which their lady greatly favored, all of the drinks chilling in ice buckets. Her ladies placed a tray in front of her, containing a beer and her first tequila, tomato juice, and Tabasco. Taking a healthy drink, she quickly washed it down with an even thirstier gulp of beer.
That tastes like life itself, she shouted happily.
Her ladies-in-waiting laughed nervously. The señorita was happy, and their job was to make her even happier, to provide amusing conversation, excellent food, to take her horseback riding, if she so wished, and to buy her pleasing clothes. When their lady was forced to compose letters or memos, they took dictation. They retailed salacious gossip, including tales of their own erotic exploits, fanned and massaged her, inundated her with the most unbelievably fulsome flattery, anything and everything to keep her entertained. Desperate to make and keep her happy, they understood that the consequences of displeasing their lady were almost too painful to contemplate. Each year, her majordomo dispatched scouts to examine the daughters of the country's wealthiest families, and from them, she chose her new crop of court ladies. They were invariably the most talented, beautiful daughters in all of Sinaloa, and often the most spoiled. For such daughters, serving their lady could be an ordeal. She tolerated no insubordination. Those who rebelled, she did not send to the rack and the stone. Those ladies, she handed over to her priests, who promptly pitched them into El Volcán de Colima, a fire-belching, smoke-billowing volcano in Tabasco. Consequently, none of her court ladies dreamed of discomfiting their lady, let alone defying her. She devoured her chile rellenos and mole poblano and gulped down her drinks with breathtaking alacrity and a resounding belch. She was in a good mood. Her ladies continued their pleasant, playful banter. "Our lady had a good time last night?" Rosalita asked, "a night of wonder and revelation." Rosalita was dressed in a sheer red close-fitting toga, scarlet lipstick and nail polish, as well as matching riding boots. Her obsidian black hair hung down to her waist. She was the most beautiful of Lady Dolorosa's court attendants. She also was a skilled pianist and had an exquisite singing voice. "Wonder and fornication is what you mean," her lady answered. "Talk about commitment. What's his name actually wore me out?" The Lady Dolorosa could never remember any of her lover's names. "He performed all night?" Rosalita asked. "When I woke up this morning, I needed every ounce of strength to make it to the bathroom. It was all I could do to wash up and brush my hair, which looked like a hawk's badly ripped up roost." "Your beauty inspired them to such exalted heights," Roberta said. A shy, demure blonde in a black dress and matching heels. She wasn't as much fun as the others, but was a superlative harpist and also had a melodic voice to match.
"Stark terror inspired him to such ecstatic heights," the señorita said, shaking her head.
"I find that hard to believe," Roberta said meekly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.